Welcome. We're glad you're joining us over video for our worship experience here at Cornerstone Baptist Church today. In just a moment, we're going to be led in worship by our praise team, and then I'm going to bring another message from God's Word out of 1 Thessalonians, and I hope that you've got your Bible ready, and we'll be looking at this morning chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. So if you want to get your Bible out and be reading that and preparing for the message, that would be good. Let's pray together as we get started. Father, we thank you today for your love. We thank you for your presence in our life. And God, we just pray that you will minister to our hearts today through your Holy Spirit, through the music and the teaching of your word. And I pray that everyone listening will be blessed by being a part of this worship experience. For we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the middle of a storm, louder. sparing any my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. And I was breathing the night of light. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. Saved my soul.
Now your freedom.
Now your freedom is all that I know. The old maid knew. Jesus, when I met you, just when you called my name, and I ran out of that grave.
Together, I need a rescue.
I need a rescue. My sin was heavy. The chains break out the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my
Oh, you chose my name. Let's have a moment of giving our tithes and offerings as an act of worship, as we usually do. You can give online by clicking the link below this video, by visiting cornerstonegso.org, or by texting the word GIVE to 336-565-7577. If giving online is more of a nuisance than a convenience for you, you can always mail a check. Please contact Cindy in our church office, and she will gladly answer any questions you may have or help you with your giving as we continue to have services online. Church, let's be generous together. The food item to give this month to Greensboro Urban Ministry is canned tomatoes. Give with us, bring your donations to the service, and look for the blue barrel. Next Sunday morning, we will have a brief business meeting in both of our in-person services. Church members, you should have already received an email or letter from our stewardship team with information about our budget for the coming church year. A question and answer session will be held in room 132 this Thursday, August 27th at 6 p.m. Remember, you can join us in person or through conference call to ask questions. Tell your money where to go instead of wondering where it went. Join our virtual Financial Peace University class and learn to make a budget you'll actually stick to. We'll meet online so you won't even have to leave home. Visit Cornerstone's website or social media to sign up for our class now and start your 14-day free trial of Financial Peace. Classes begin Monday, September 21st.
Here's a question every spiritual leader must ask. Are the people I lead getting the real thing from me? In other words, am I genuine? Am I sincere? Am I giving people the real, in my case, Rick Byrd? If you're a spiritual leader of any kind, if you're a preacher, if you're a Sunday school teacher, a Bible study leader, it's a question that you and I must ask ourselves. Am I real? Am I the same when I'm leading people as I am when I'm away, maybe off by myself, doing my own thing? Am I the same person all the time? When the veneer is stripped away, who do folks really see? Do they see the Wizard of Oz pulling the levers or pushing the buttons of ministry only to discover that all of the activity comes with no reality? Unfortunately, authenticity is a rare trait among spiritual leaders. Considering that Jesus was the most authentic person who ever lived, it is unthinkable that any person who claims to follow him would live anything but an authentic life. Paul, Daniel, Hosea, and a host of other biblical characters were men who when you saw them, you got the real thing. You, what you saw was what you got. They were real. They were genuine. They were authentic. God expects you and me to be real as well. The Apostle Paul's life and testimony were open for inspection. He was not ashamed of what that inspection would reveal. Now, enemies of the gospel were having success in convincing the Thessalonian believers that Paul and Silas and Timothy were frauds, like so many other spiritual teachers of that time. As uncomfortable as it was for Paul to have to defend himself, he urged his audience to remember their own experience with him and his companions. Look what it says there in the very first verse of chapter 2. For you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain. That word vain there means empty. It could denote something that was without effect or importance. But the ministry of Paul and his companions in Thessalonica was not empty. It had profound impact upon the people. It produced marks of genuine faith. Paul's already recollected these marks back in chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. Paul talks about how strong their faith was and how they were models of Christianity. The strength of the Thessalonian church was evidence that Paul was an authentic spiritual leader. Paul wanted there to be no question, no misunderstanding about him or his ministry. So he shares here in the beginning of chapter 2 qualities of an authentic spiritual leader, the kind of minister, the kind of servant of Christ that every believer should be. So here's what I want you to take from the message this morning. Authentic Christian leaders demonstrate certain spiritual qualities that affirm them as God's servants. Here in verses 1 through 6 of chapter 2, Paul sets forth four qualities of authentic Christian leaders. First of all, I want you to see the first quality is tenacity. The spiritual leader, the authentic spiritual leader, is confident in God's power. Look what Paul says in verse 2. But though we had already suffered and been shamefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we had boldness, he says, in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. Friend, Paul's statement here makes it clear. Bold biblical preaching does not lead to popularity. Rather, it leads to conflict that requires courage, that it calls for renewed boldness. Right before Paul launched his mission into Thessalonica, remember, he had been shamefully mistreated and imprisoned by certain leaders in Philippi, and he was forced to leave the city. Well, instead of pressing on to Thessalonica from Philippi, Paul and Silas could have given up. They could have just decided to quit. They could have looked at their treatment there in Philippi and decided that they weren't qualified to be servants of the gospel, to be spiritual leaders. They could have easily decided just to turn back to Antioch. They could have felt disqualified or at least unqualified by the persecution they had endured. But instead, it's interesting, they pushed ahead. They continued boldly preaching the gospel. Now in Thessalonica, Paul left Philippi. He ends up in Thessalonica, and there Paul preached the gospel boldly again. And again, Paul faced persecution. Did that discourage him? Did it cause him to give up? No. He continued to boldly preach the gospel. Paul wholeheartedly trusted that God would sustain him, that if he just proclaimed the truth, that if he would continue to do what God had set him on course to do, then God would take care of him. Friend, Paul knew something authentic spiritual leaders learn sooner or later. Pain, suffering, brokenness, mistakes, and setbacks are a part of ministry. Tenacity under such circumstances is proof of an authentic spiritual leader. There is always pressure to soften the message, trust me, to be inoffensive, to make the gospel acceptable to sinners. But we are to boldly preach the gospel regardless of the results. We must trust in the power of God that when we preach and we proclaim the truth, and even if that truth is rejected, and even if we are criticized and ridiculed, then we must trust that God is there to energize our ministry and protect us from harm. That's the first thing I want you to see about an authentic spiritual leader as we look at Paul, and that is tenacity, to keep on keeping on even when there is the pressure to quit and to run. The second characteristic of an authentic Christian leader is integrity. The authentic Christian leader is faithful to God's truth. Look what Paul says in verse 3. He said, "For our appeal does not spring from error or impurity or any attempt to deceive." You see, Paul didn't show up at the Thessalonians' doorstep wheeling and dealing with a wink in his eye and a trick up his sleeve. He was no charlatan. He was no sweet talker. He was no half-truth teller like the minister in Sinclair Lewis's Elmer Gantry. You remember? Lewis defines Gantry as manipulating, entertaining, uncompassionate, pompous, and ambitious. He had no heart for God or for God's people. Paul, on the other hand, spoke to the Thessalonians with integrity. Now, that word integrity means blameless or consistent. A person of integrity is honest. They're without hypocrisy. They're without duplicity. Paul was a what you see is what you get kind of person. There was no hidden agenda, no manipulation, no forked tongue with the Apostle Paul. Paul knew he could be confident in God's power because he was faithful to God's truth, not only in his preaching, but also in his living. Friend, those who oppose God's word often try to destroy preachers and teachers by persecution, mistreatment. But when that doesn't work, they try to undermine people's trust in the spiritual leader's message or his own personal integrity. That often happened to Paul. He believed it necessary to defend his integrity by affirming his unwavering commitment to God's truth in both speech and conduct. First, Paul was faithful to preach the truth. He declared, "Our appeal does not spring from error." Paul did not stray from the truth of divine revelation. He assured the Thessalonians there was no error in his teaching. He was faithful to speak the truth. Several years ago, Larry King interviewed a well-known pastor on television. He asked about those who don't accept Christ, such as Jews and Muslims. "Are they not going to heaven?" King asked. The response from his guest, a prominent so-called Christian leader, was, "Yeah, I don't know, Larry. I'm very careful about saying who would and who wouldn't go to heaven. I don't know." The problem with that pastor's response is in not wanting to offend anyone on national television, he was willing to compromise the clear teaching of Scripture. Scripture tells us Anyone who dies without Christ will not go to heaven. Friend, give us spiritual leaders who know the truth, who will declare the truth, who will stand with men like Polycarp, Luther, Whitfield, Edwards, and others, and declare from the rooftops that the gospel is the only power of God unto salvation. Paul was faithful to preach the truth. He was also faithful to practice the truth. He affirmed that his message did not originate from impurity or any attempt to deceive. Paul and his companions were not sexually immoral leaders. They spoke the truth out of clean and pure lives. Their motives were righteous, and they lived and ministered with utmost integrity. Paul wanted nothing more than to carry out his ministry without any sense of immorality or deception. Friend, not unlike the first century, the gospel, God's truth, is coming under attack again and again today. There are many assaults upon the purity and the exclusivity of the gospel. There is the pressure to compromise, both in our preaching the truth and in our living out that truth. It is imperative that every leader of Christ's church act with integrity and remain faithful to the truth. Integrity should mark all believers, but most of all, the one who has the most at stake, the one who is God's mouthpiece, the one who is God's spokesman, the one who is the model for other Christians, the example, the spiritual leader. Paul wants us to see that integrity is a mark of an authentic spiritual leader. A third characteristic of an authentic Christian leader is accountability. This implies that the authentic spiritual leader is motivated not by man's approval, but by God's approval. Look what Paul says in verses 4 and 5. He said, "But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak not to please man, but to please God who tests our hearts. For we never came with words of flattery, as you know, nor with a pretext for greed. God is our witness. The preaching of the truth is not always popular. A preacher can be tempted at times to tone down his message in order to please people. However, note what Paul says. He sought only to please God, not men. And there were two strong reasons why. First, God was the one who had entrusted Paul with the gospel, not men." That's what he says there in the first part of verse 4. Paul realized that he was chosen by God. God had called him. He was set apart by God. He was saved by God. He was redeemed by God. He was commissioned by God. He was enlightened by God, instructed by God, appointed by God, empowered by God, and directed by God. So consequently, why would Paul now seek to please men rather than God? So that's the first thing. Second, a strong sense of accountability to God came from the constant realization that Paul had that the Lord alone would try his heart and judge him. That's what he's referring to there in the latter part of verse 4. Paul knew that in the last day it would be God before whom he would stand. He will be judged not by men or angels, but by God. And he will either be rewarded or passed over. So it is God whom he must please. And there is only one message that pleases God, and that is the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is salvation by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Paul asserts that he and his companions did not go to Thessalonica using words of flattery. They weren't there to please everyone by tickling their ears with what they wanted to hear. Instead, they were there to please God by preaching the true gospel. Herbert Swope was the first winner of the Pulitzer Prize for journalism. Swope famously said, "I cannot give you the formula for success, but I can give you the formula for failure. Try to please everybody." In the 1990s, President George H.W. Bush had John Sununu as his chief of staff. Sununu was once asked by a reporter if his job as chief of staff was difficult. Sununu answered, "No." The reporter thought Sununu had misunderstood the question, so he asked him again, and he got the same reply. Sununu explained, "I have only one constituent." Friend, John Sununu knew his job, and that was to please the President of the United States. Paul and all spiritual leaders have a similar goal when it comes to sharing the gospel. They have been entrusted with to please the gospel they've been entrusted with. They have one goal, and that is to please God. We are often faced with the choice between trying to please people or trying to please God. If you please God, it doesn't matter whom you displease. But if you displease God, it doesn't matter whom you please. The authentic spiritual leader is motivated by God's approval of him and therefore seeks to please God and prays that in seeking to please God, that he will please men. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other." You see, Jesus understood we can only have one master, and as slaves of Christ, we report to him and seek his approval. Friend, ministry really is quite simple. We ultimately must seek the favor and the approval of God. In his letter to the Galatians, Paul wrote in Galatians chapter 1, verse 10, "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ." The authentic spiritual leader is motivated by God's approval. A fourth characteristic of an authentic Christian leader is found in verse 6. That is humility. He is laboring for God's glory. Children of God are commanded to be humble because Scripture sees pride as an ugly sin that the devil committed along with his other angels who joined him in his rebellion. Pride is the sin that led Adam and Eve to be thrown out of the garden. It was pride that sought to dethrone God, to strike at his sovereignty, and to replace him with self. This kind of pride naturally grips every human heart. This is why Paul was eager to let the Thessalonians know that unlike typical spiritual deceivers, he and Silas and Timothy did not seek glory or honor or praise or applause or recognition or rewards from men. They were not in ministry because of their own ambition. They were not out to be recognized as great preachers or great pastors. Paul says in verse 6, "Nor did we seek glory from people, whether from you or from others, though we could have made demands as apostles of Christ." As an apostle, handpicked by the Lord himself, empowered by the Holy Spirit to perform astonishing miracles, and acknowledged as an authority by other churches, Paul had a right to first-class treatment. Instead, Paul served the Thessalonians with humility. Paul didn't seek glory from men, nor did he play the apostles' card. Friend, abusing one's position of leadership is a powerful temptation for spiritual leaders because people tend to place spiritual leaders on a pedestal. And who doesn't like to be looked up to? But this kind of self-promoting, this kind of seeking after glory for yourself, ultimately leads to collapse and failure. Paul's labor among the Thessalonians shows us how we should lead in our own ministries today. His example to be humble is very helpful. We live in a world that exists for themselves. We live in a world that exalts self-love, self-satisfaction, and self-promotion. For the world, it is considered virtuous to exalt self. But spiritual leaders must live in a counterculture way by being models of selfless humility and give all the glory for our labor to the only one who deserves it, and that is God Himself. If you've watched The Rain on Netflix, you have the wrong impression of John Knox, the Scottish reformer. The way Knox was depicted in that show was nothing like the man he really was. Knox was one of the most courageous men to walk the earth with the gospel. Knox, at one time, was a Roman Catholic priest in Scotland before he was converted by the power of the gospel. When Bloody Mary took the throne, John Knox fled Scotland and went to Geneva to pastor an English-speaking congregation. He even played a role in the production of the Geneva Bible. Once Bloody Mary was removed from her throne, Knox returned to Scotland. At that time, Mary, Queen of Scots, took on the throne. And on her very first Sunday as Queen of Scotland, she went into her own private chapel where she received Mass. News of that reached John Knox, and on the very next Sunday at St. Giles Church in Edinburgh, John Knox stepped into the pulpit and called out the Queen. He declared, "One Mass is more fearful to me than 10,000 armed enemies were landed in any part of this realm. I have learned to plainly and boldly to call wickedness by its own terms." Mary was infuriated. She summoned Knox to give an account of his declaration. Knox came in, and immediately Mary went on the offensive. She brought three charges against Knox, and yet the charges deflected off him like water on a duck's back. Knox did not mince words when he stood before the Queen and declared the idolatry of the Mass, asserting it could have no place in Scotland, for it would invite the judgment of God upon the nation. Knox was unrelenting as he further went on to preach the one true saving gospel to Mary, Queen of Scots. Mary was reduced to tears. Knox records she began to howl like a wounded animal. That encounter between John Knox, the Scottish reformer, and Mary, Queen of Scots, was the first of six encounters between the two of them and was the cause of the Reformation in Scotland. When John Knox died on December the 24th, 1572 in Edinburgh, these long-remembered words were spoken over his grave. "Here lies a man who in his life never feared the face of man." Perhaps Knox is best summarized by the closing words of the Scots Confession that he himself penned in 1560 upon his return to Scotland. It goes like this: "Arise, O Lord, and let thine enemies be confounded. Let them flee from thy presence that hate thy godly name. Give thy servants to speak thy word with boldness, and let all nations cleave to the true knowledge of thee. Friend, where are such spiritual leaders today? As someone observed, the problem with preachers today is no one wants to kill them anymore. Where are those who will say with the Apostle Paul, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you receive, he is to be accursed? Authentic Christian leaders demonstrate certain spiritual qualities that affirm them as God's servants. Tenacity. They keep on keeping on because they are confident in the power of God to see them through. Integrity. They are faithful to speak about the truth of God and to conduct their lives by that truth. Accountability. They seek God's approval, not man's. And humility. They do everything they do to bring glory to God and not themselves. May God raise up in our day more and more authentic spiritual leaders. Would you pray with me? Father, we pray today that you will help us as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ to live authentic lives. Lord, I pray today that whether you're a pastor of a church, whether you're a Sunday school teacher, a Bible study leader, a parent in the home, a grandparent, whether you're a school teacher, whatever your occupation may be, if you have any influence over other believers, Lord, I pray that we would understand that people are looking to us to see what kind of example we are setting. And I pray that beginning with those in spiritual leadership in our churches and moving all throughout our congregations, to every lay person, to every member of each body of Christ, local body of Christ, Lord, that we would strive to not only trust the truth of your word, but to live it out so that others may see that we are sincere servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. We love you. We praise you. We thank you for calling us to salvation and calling us to service. For we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, friend. Hope to see you in church soon. If not, I hope you'll continue listening through this video.